morning, everyone. It's good to see everyone here this morning. We have a bunch of folks that we're missing, and hopefully some of them will show up later. But I do want to remind everyone of some of the announcements. We always want to remember to pray for one another. We have great opportunities that we can share in our prayers for one another, and I know we do a good job of that. We also, I think, do a good job of keeping up with one another and seeing what some of the issues might be. We always want to remind everyone concerning our desire to pray for our leadership, to pray for those that we know of that are being persecuted, and also to pray for our brethren that we support, and that we can remember them in our prayers and to remember one another as well. We have in the bulletin there are a number of folks that we do want to remember, and there's more information there than I'll mention here, but do continue to remember one another in our prayers. Sherry is planning on, we're going to get to see the doctor the 14th, I believe, and hopefully then have an opportunity to plan whatever the surgery might be. Good to see Mike back with us this morning, and I know he's still hurting a little bit, but the therapy is helping, so it's good to see him this morning. Kathy Dean's also been undergoing her therapy, and of course that's painful, but showing some improvement as well. Heard from Billy Mays earlier, just past week recently, and he had colonoscopy in an upper GI, and they also did an ultrasound on his legs and found that he did have a blood clot. That was what started all of this, was his legs were swelling up so bad. So they're going to treat that medically rather than with surgery, and so he's going through a lot physically right now as well. And others that we want to remember as well. And also today we're going to be enjoying a potluck together, and already seen some good information. Gary said the pots are very lucky today, so always enjoy that. And today is a special day of celebration today, June 4th. 70 years ago, this couple sitting up here at the front got married. So. Celebrating their 70th anniversary today, so we'll celebrate with them today. That's an accomplishment. A lot of people don't even live 70 years, but to be able to stay married together for 70 years is a great accomplishment. And the Lord has blessed them greatly, so we want to celebrate with them today as well.
We're going to change it to anniversary again.
Go right ahead. As always, we want to remind you of opportunities that we have to assemble and to worship together for Bible study. And we have Bible classes available for everyone, so take advantage of all those opportunities. And, you know, there are times, I know all of you have experienced this, that you just kind of feel like you're out of gas, you don't feel good, you just hurt a little bit. But it's always been my experience that when you come anyway, you feel better after having been with people that love you and that can encourage you. And so you just have to kind of keep that in mind and say, that's important, and you'll be blessed for it. In our worship this morning, our first song will be on number 599, Step Into the Light. The words of this song remind us of our the importance of our efforts to follow Jesus, stepping in the light, following him, and imitating his life. In Isaiah chapter 2, the prophet recorded, "O house of Jacob, come and let us walk in the light of the Lord." In 1 John 1, John recorded, "This is the message we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. These are great promises that we have from God, and certainly it's important for us that we be sure that we're walking as we should, and stepping in the light, following example of our Savior and King.
Trying to walk in the steps of the Savior, trying to follow our Savior and King, shaping our lives by His blessed example. Happy, how happy the songs that we bring. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, stepping in the light, stepping in the light. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, led in paths of light. Pressing more closely to Him who is leading, when we are tempted to turn from the way. Trusting the arm that is strong to defend us, happy, how happy. Stepping in the light, stepping in the light. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, led in paths of light. Walking in footsteps of gentle forbearance, footsteps of faithfulness, mercy, and love. Looking to Him for the grace freely promised, happy, how happy our journey above. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, stepping in the light, stepping in the light. How beautiful to walk in the steps of the Savior, led in paths of light.
This time we'll have opportunity for our contribution this morning.
As we are here this morning to worship the Lord, we're also one of the instructions for how to worship given to the church in Corinth, 1 Corinthians 16, verse 1. Paul instructed them to be able to give to the work of the church. And so as we do that, she also talks about later how to be able to do that, to make sure that we are giving. It's a sacrifice, but it's also an opportunity to show our love towards the Lord if we do it in a way that is pleasing to Him. So as we give to Him, we are using this opportunity to be able to show our support for the work that's here, to be able to show to ourselves and to others the love that we have for the Lord. And so let's pray together as we enter into this part of our worship. Heavenly Father, we come before You and we thank You for giving us everything. We talked this morning in one of our classes about the fact that You were there creating everything before any of us were even a thought. And so we know all of this is Yours. But as we give this morning, we pray that You bless the work here. That as we make decisions on how to spend the money here, that we do so in a way that brings glory and honor to You, that You are pleased with how we do that. And of course, we thank You for Your Son and His sacrifice, and it's in His name that we pray. Amen.
song would be number 328, In the Hour of Trial. The words of this song occasionally are used as part of the, in thinking about the sacrifice of the Lord, the Lord's Supper. But most of the words of this song are talking about the trials that we have. And whenever we have trials, whenever we have trouble, that we do have someone who understands. As we sing the words of this song, thinking about the confidence that we have in our Lord to be able to have, to know that He will intercede for us and to plead for us, as the words express. In Matthew chapter 10, Jesus said, "So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven." Also, the writer to the Hebrews, describing Jesus, he said the former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But he, speaking of Jesus, he holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Truly, words of comfort for us in realizing that there is, as we encourage one another to continue in prayer, to know that Jesus can intercede for us as we strive to draw near to God. After we sing the words of this song together, then Robert Scott is going to lead us in our prayer.
In the hour of trial, Jesus, plead for me, lest by base denial I depart from thee. When thou seest me waver, with a look together worship you and
and together fellowship in the work of this congregation. We're thankful for the health that we enjoy. We're thankful for the opportunities that you give us to not only serve you, but to serve others. We realize that there are several in the congregation who are not well, and we pray that you be with each one of them. We pray that you continue to be with Kathy as she's recovering and as she is going through pain in order to regain her strength and to regain her ability to use her entire body, actually, but mainly her shoulder area. We're thankful for the fact that Johnny could be with us today and that Mike could be with us today in spite of their ongoing difficulties. We pray that you'd help the progress that's being made and continue it so that both of them might return to their complete activity in the congregation and that we might enjoy being with them always. We know that there are others that are having difficulties, and we pray that you would be with them also. Help all of us to remember that we are to put you first and to put the kingdom, the church, before anything else in this world, so that we might better not only serve you, but to be able to get your message to those that are around us, that they too might have the opportunity to serve you as they should. Help us this morning as we continue in our worship, that each one of us might be able to concentrate properly, that each one of us might be able to express to you the feelings that we have that we call worship, and that we might be able to overcome the thoughts of the world and to put you first. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Before we take the Lord's Supper together, we'll sing number 359, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross. The words of this song are expressions on our part that, in a sense, if we're near the cross, then we remember the cross. And not only as we remembered each first day of the week, but that each day of our lives, that we live in a way that we recognize that we should be close to Jesus and remembering all that he's done for us. In Isaiah 41, the prophet recorded, when the poor and needy seek water, and there is none, and their tongue is parched with thirst, I, the Lord, will answer them. I, the God of Israel, will not forsake them. I will open rivers on the bare heights and fountains in the midst of the valleys, and I will make the wilderness a pool of water and the dry land springs of water. The context of this is speaking of the times of the Messiah, and even as Jesus said that for those that followed him, he would give living water, and we would become fountains of living water. In Matthew 5, Jesus also said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. And Paul also mentioned in his letter to the Galatians, far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. And those are the thoughts that this word, the song, expresses, that we keep ourselves alive with Jesus, and that the world is crucified to us, but that we might live faithfully for him. After we sing this song together, we'll partake the Lord's Supper together.
Jesus, keep me near the cross, there a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, O Lamb of God, rain it sings before me.
Sometimes we use different terminology to express who we are or how we feel. Sometimes we may say that, you know, someone asks how we're doing, we say, well, I'm here. Sometimes we'll use different terminology and, you know, we'll say stuff that, you know, allows us to kind of understand how we feel and how we do. And when we think about the Lord's Day, you know, a lot of times when we ask questions during the week, we'll say, well, it's just another day. But this is more than just another day. This is a day set aside by our Heavenly Father. It's not just a terminology. It's a fact that every Christian on this day, on the Lord's Day, should be setting aside time to partake of the Lord's Supper. It's to start us off in a week that will allow us to remember the most important event that's ever taken place in the history of mankind. And that it is that Jesus died on that cruel cross so that we can be saved. When we understand this, we understand that the first day of the week is the Lord's Day. It's not our day. But in being the Lord's Day, he's taking care of us. He's showing us what we can do and how we can feel about the Lord. You know, there's a lot of things in life we forget, especially as we get older. We forget how old we really are sometimes. And it's easy to know that in life we can forget things that are most important to us. You know, one thing we think about is anniversaries and birthdays. And you know, it's good to have the Scots that they're having 70 years. What a good example to every one of us. And to think about the things that we need to remember, you know, Brother Scott doesn't need to forget that. His wife may remind him of it. But if we forget the most important thing that's ever happened in the history of time, the Lord dying on the cross, we have forgot something. And we're not paying attention to something that means so much to us, to remember Jesus Christ and what he's done for us on the cross. Just think of all those lost souls out in this world, all around us, throughout this community and throughout the world, who do not know Christ. That's an awful thing to forget. Every one of those people have Jesus Christ as their Savior if they want Him to be their Savior, if they do what's right, and if they follow Him. When you look upon the cross on this day, you look upon a time that changed the history of mankind. We were changed from being lost to being saved. That's just hard to fathom. That Jesus Christ was upon that cross and died for us. And that we can overcome the sins of the world that condemn us. We were absolutely condemned. But Jesus paid the price. So as we remember this day, let's remember that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And He's the one that has the power to save our souls.
Heavenly Father, we come before You again this morning, and we thank You for providing us with this way to remember Your Son and our Savior. As we partake of this bread, we ask You to help us think on His body, think on the sacrifice that He made, remembering that the sacrifice was for us, and that He was showing His love for you and His love for us. And as we partake and think on these things, we pray that that thought lingers on throughout the week. We think back to the cross, and we are able to show our love for you and our love for Him by our obedience to you. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
As we continue to remember the blood which was shed upon that cross, let us remember the only cleansing agent in this world that could cleanse us of our sin, and that is the blood of Christ.
Heavenly Father, as we partake of this fruit of the vine, again, we thank You for giving us this way to remember the blood that takes away our sin. And as we partake of this cup and think on His body on the cross that was pierced multiple times, that was flowing with the eternal life-giving blood, we thank You for Your love for us and this plan that You developed before we were even a thought, before time began. And we thank You for seeing it through to the horrible conclusion with the death of Your Son, with the life of us. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
and we'll sing number 291, I Know Not Why, God's Wondrous Grace. And the rest of that is, to me, He has made known. In Paul's writing to Timothy, he said, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, His prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. This is why I suffer as I do, but I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I'm convinced that He's able to guard until that day what has been entrusted to me. Follow the pattern of the sound words that you have heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. We recognize and have remembered the sacrifice Jesus made for us. And Paul's encouragement to Timothy and encouragement for all of us is that we shouldn't be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, because truly this wondrous grace has been made available to us, to all of mankind. And therefore it's important for us to be able to let others know of that availability, and especially in following and keeping the way of our Lord. If it's convenient for you, would you stand with me while we're singing together?
I know not why God's wondrous grace to me He hath made known, nor why the worthy Christ in love redeemed me for His own. But I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that He is able to
number 389, we're sitting after Gary's lesson this morning.
Good morning. So before I flood you with information on Noah and the Ark, okay, just a quick commercial. We have the latest version of House to House, Heart to Heart, that has been sent out to neighboring homes. So 3,000-ish. It's a little bit more than that that have gone out. But we also have a few extra copies. As you go out the door, it's on the right and on the far right of the table. And, yeah, I mean, there's some good stuff in here, but, you know, there's questions to answer, there's quizzes to take, there's puzzles to fill in, and some really good information concerning the Bible, and also even more opportunity to get more information if you want to fill that out and send it in. So good for us to be able to study and learn, but also good for us to be able to share with others, because our contact information is on here as well. And they slipped in something new this time when it came out. They have it's a Bible correspondence course. They've got some books, God's Design for the Family. And so there are eight different lessons, eight different books, and they gave us extras of each one for us to be able to look at. If you are interested in looking at God's Design for the Family, I'm also going to put these back there. They are, again, available for us to be able to look at, but also if you know somebody that would be interested in learning God's Design for the Family, it is here, and if we need more, let me know, and I know somebody that can make that happen. Okay. Hey, we're going to talk about knowing the Ark. And there's a lot of discussion about this from time to time. This story pops back up, and I'm going to say a story because, well, you know, it is a story of what happened. But sometimes we lump that into, it's a fable. It's a made-up thing, and a lot of the world seem to think that, because it is just fantastical to be wondering how in the world did eight people get a bunch of critters and load them onto this floating box and survive for all that time. It seems, like it's impossible. Almost, you might say, miraculous. I'll go along with that. It's miraculous. But again, did it really happen? And so we'll cover just a bit of did it really happen this morning, but also want to look at some of the things that we see in this story that we should be picking up. And so hopefully you'll be able to take something from it. Was there a worldwide flood? And there are a lot of questions that we could ask. We could spend a really, really long time on it, but there's food next door, so we won't spend a really, really long time on it. We'll just look at a few questions this morning about it. And this question, well, it's a tough question for some Christians to answer. Because, well, science says this. My eyeballs say this. My brain seems to be thinking this. Maybe it's exaggerated just a little bit, and there's a way that we can try to mix this together and come up with some type of an answer. Maybe it wasn't the entire world was covered by water. Maybe it was just, the world as Noah knew it was flooded. My answer to Christians, every time, as well as anybody else, you got a Bible question, well, what if we just let the Bible answer for us? And if somebody asks a question like, was there a worldwide flood, what does the Bible say? Well, let's see what it says. Genesis chapter 7, verse number 17, the flood continued 40 days on the earth. The waters increased and bore up the ark, and it rose high above the earth. The waters prevailed and increased greatly on the earth. The ark floated on the face of the waters, and the waters prevailed so mightily on the earth that all the high mountains under the whole heaven were covered. That seems pretty worldwide to me. The waters prevailed above the mountains, covering them 15 cubits deep, and all the flesh died that moved on the earth, birds, livestock, beasts, all swarming creatures that swarm on the earth, and all mankind. Everything on the dry land in whose nostrils was the breath of life died. He blotted out every living thing that was on the face of the ground, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens. They were blotted out from the earth. Only Noah was left and those who were with him in the ark. And the waters prevailed on the earth 150 days. And just, again, people have a problem with it because they can't go back and Google and find the pictures of here's when it really happened. They didn't have the technology for the underwater cameras at that time. And so, again, it just, that seems really hard, but again, there are Christians who, yes, I believe in the flood. Yes, I believe of Noah in the ark, but it wasn't as broad as it says, because it sounds like I'm making up things. But with what we're looking at, again, in this particular story, that it doesn't make any sense for us to say that this particular area, this valley, this this region was flooded and everything else was just the way it was. Because if that's the case, why gather up the animals? Again, he was gathering up all of these animals and trying to get them onto this box, this ark. You know, why even build it in the first place? There's a flood coming. Again, because this took a little while to build. So if he knew, his weather app was saying, well, I'm sorry, God said, I'm going to flood the earth. So he knew it was coming. He was preparing for it. Why in the world would you build an ark if this was just going to be, you're going to get really wet around here? You should be able to find some high ground somewhere else. Move. We look at the end of the story and God putting the rainbow there in the sky and saying, I'm showing you my promise. All right, I'm never going to flood the earth again. I'm not going to wipe out man by flooding the entire earth ever again. Well, we see a lot of rainbows. And if you live in California, you see a lot of floods and landslides and other things too. But there are floods all over the world. So if this was just a local flood, then God's not keeping his promise, and we probably need to be worried about the promise of eternal life. But because God can't lie, he is keeping his promise, and he promised it exactly the way that he said he did. He's not going to flood the entire earth again. And so, of course, we have the scriptures to be able to point at to it. We have other ways to be able to see that as well. Some of the complaints of people, look, there's the story of Noah and the ark. It's in the Bible. This is just the Jewish version of a flood, an animal saved and some people being saved. Everybody's got one of those. And there are hundreds of Noah-like stories. I mean, some that it's just one guy on a boat and some animals. Or maybe it's sometimes it's eight people and a boat and some animals. But there's some type of a story that all these cultures have. There are a lot of different, traditions and stories that are passed down all over the world. Six continents and multiple nations. I don't know of the Antarctic version of Noah and the Ark. But all the rest of them, there are stories of it. And I think I've shared this before, but even the Chinese have a version of Noah and the Ark. And you look at when you look at their symbol, because they write their alphabet's a little bit different than ours, or their words. So there is the word for boat. When they say boat, ours looks like that. Theirs looks like this. Well, when you break that down, there is vessel and eight and people. So when Chinese people are writing the word boat, they're writing about where they got it from, and it's that story. And so, well, wait a minute, with all these different stories, just different versions. Well, amazing enough, everybody's got the same story. Man, boat, animals. Well, that's because it happened. And there were eight people who survived. And Grandpa, tell me about that time you stayed on the boat with all those animals for that really long time. Okay, I'll tell you that story again. And then let me tell you about that time my grandpa was on the boat with all those animals and spent a really long time on there. And it was passed down and passed down. And so, yes, amazingly enough, even when the languages changed, they were able to tell that same old story, that great, 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 great granddad that time he was on the boat with all those animals. There's a reason we all share that same story. It's because it happened. And we have proof, of course, straight from God. We also have proof out in the great state of Nebraska, Agate Springs. I meant to look at that. It's probably not Agate, but Agate Springs, Nebraska. So there's this area out there where you can go, and it's, in their mountains, which look a lot like hills to us. So in these areas, they would dig from time to time, and you can go out there and dig today and find a bunch of bones of a bunch of different animals. And what they're hypothesizing is that some grand event, something happened where there was a lot of water, and it just flowed them all together and buried them in a bunch of mud, and then they just, they died there. They were buried there, and they were also preserved there. And so for years, decades, we have been digging up bones and finding complete animals, including rhinos and camels and pigs and birds and even dinosaurs. Some scientists have a real problem with that, because that doesn't make any sense. Why would all of these animals and dinosaurs be buried together? Well, of course, they know the truth in their own mind, that the Bible story could not happen like it said, because if the Bible is true there, it could be true in other places. And so what they have decided is that to these bones that look exactly like the rhinoceros bones that we have today, or camel bones that we have today, and they must have been rhinoceros-like animals, wild boar-like animals. And so from these bones that look just like the bones that we have today, they have created fancier versions of what these prehistoric animals would have looked like. And they sell it, and people buy it. But there are also those scientists who say, here's a rhinoceros skeleton from today. Here is a rhinoceros skeleton from Nebraska. Boy, they look really close, don't they? Exactly the same. So we were able to go there and see all of these animals just piled up together, caught up in some kind of flood. Where could that have come from? I think we know. There's a reason we find fish bones on tops of mountains and in places where, you know, other than the oceanfront property in Arizona, places that don't really have oceanfront property. And all of a sudden we see a bunch of ocean fish bones. What could have happened? Well, we know. And scientists fight against it. But with that particular story, again, he is bringing all of these animals on there. This is a lot of animals to fit onto a boat. How did he gather all of the animals? I know. We should let the Bible answer. So let's see what Genesis 6 and verse 20 says. Of the birds according to their kinds, and the animals according to their kinds, of every creeping thing of the ground according to its kind, two of every sort shall come into you to keep them alive. Here are God's instructions. Build the ark. I am going to fill it for you. I'm going to send you the animals. So, Noah didn't have to go on this year-long expedition to gather all the animals of the world and try to herd them in the right direction. The ark's built. It's time to get on. The animals appear, ready to get on. But was it even large enough to hold all the animals? And again, if we read the scriptures, it says yes. Well, how did that happen? God said it was going to happen. God said it did happen, and it happened. If you were telling me that God said, I'm putting all of these animals on a John boat, and you're going to be out there floating, okay. He got it on there somehow. We know, of course, that it was slightly larger than a John boat. It was a pretty big box that was out there. Genesis chapter 6, verse 14, make yourself an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and out with pitch. This is how you're going to make it. The length of the ark, 300 cubits. Its breadth, 50 cubits. Its height, 30 cubits. Make a roof of the ark and finish it to a cubit above, and set the door of the ark in its side. Make it with lower, second, and third decks. And so we're looking at about 1.4 million cubic feet. About 520 rail cars. You know, that's what it feels like when you have that train go by and you're sitting there counting and counting. And you think you're going to get to 520. Most of the time it's only about 50, and it seems like a lot. Can you imagine 10 times that and what it's able to hold? So I got pictures here again. I don't know that Google was able to actually go take pictures of it and get the dimensions of all of these and get real versions. So we got the cartoon version. Here's about what the ark is, about 450 feet long, versus the Titanic and a 747. But again, it would hold a lot. We don't have to prove it scientifically. Because then we start looking at, okay, now we're going to take the Bible, all these different things we're going to talk, we're going to have to prove it scientifically. There was a man that was dead for 3 days, and he came back to life. I'm not proving that scientifically. We have an axe head that just started floating up. We have water that was moved to the side so the entire nation of people could walk through on dry ground. Oh, yeah, it came back together about the time their enemies were chasing after them. 6 days to create an entire universe and have it ready to be lived in by the people who were created on the sixth day. God's in control. God is powerful. God can do anything that he wants to do. He wanted to save Noah and his family. He wanted to save some animals, and that's exactly what he did. Thankfully, because, well, we'd have a hard time being here if there were no people to keep growing people. But what are we getting from this? Again, just a couple of things that we can see just coming from Noah and the ark. Because we tell a story, we draw pictures and color, one of my favorite places to eat in Dahlonega is this pizza place, and we even named pizzas after it. That's their meat lover's pizza. It's called the Noah's Ark. It's great. That's probably, that I can't believe they would do something like that. But it's really good, too. But again, what lessons can we learn from this story that we tell our kids? Because, again, this is showing God's power, but it also shows the severity and grace of God. Look at Romans 11, verse 22. Note then the kindness and the severity of God. Severity towards those who have fallen, but God's kindness to you, provided you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you too will be cut off. Again, look, he was talking about Gentiles, and so look, he's kind to you. He's brought you into his family now. But notice what he's done with the children of Israel. They've been cut off because they're not willing to follow after him. So his kindness is shown to those who are following after him, severity to those who are disobedient to him, those who are not following after him. And so we see that in Genesis chapter 6. Verse number 1, when man began to multiply on the face of the land and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were attractive. They took as their wives any they chose. Then the Lord said, my spirit shall not abide in man forever, for he is flesh, his days shall be 120 years. The Nephilim were on the earth, and in those days also afterward, when the sons of God came in to the daughters of man, they bore children to them. These were the mighty men who were of old, the men of renown. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord regretted that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I will blot out man, whom I have created from the face of the land, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens, for I am sorry that I have made them. A reminder to us, yes, God is full of love and grace and long-suffering. But his patience can be worn out. And at this particular time that we're reading about in Genesis chapter 6, he said, I've had enough. I regret making man because, again, every single thought was, how can I be evil? And so he did something about it. And again, it wasn't just as he took a snapshot and said, okay, yeah, I don't like what I'm seeing here. Let's start over. It wasn't a knee-jerk reaction. He saw his creation. He was there before the creation. He's there after the creation. He sees man living on the earth and sees how that is going. And, well, he's patient because he doesn't kill everybody the first time that they sin. And then, again, allowing the earth to, you know, the people to grow on the earth and live and make poor decisions. And he doesn't kill them every single time something bad happens. But eventually, his long suffering is exhausted. But God found Noah. Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. We get the benefit of the grace that God offered to Noah. God didn't have to save him. But he did. Yes, he had already promised that through the seed of woman that we'd have this Savior that's coming. Well, Jesus already said he could raise up people from stones. He had already created man from dust. He could also create the same people from dust and be able to fulfill the promise that he made. But he found Noah and his family and saved him, of course, and some of the animals. And so we, too, are the same way. We have the grace of God that he offers us. Again, was Noah saved because he built the ark? Yes, absolutely. Because he did what God said to do. Are we saved by obeying the gospel and living the life that he wants us to live? Absolutely. Because we're saved when we obey God completely. Not because we're awesome people, not because we've done something that now, you know, we are totally worth salvation. It's grace. God doesn't have to save us, but he does. We see the patterns of God in the story of Noah and the ark. And God gave Noah some instructions. Again, we've already talked about, again, this how big to make it, how, you know, put rooms in it, make different levels in it, put a door in the side. All these things, this is the pattern. And so, you know, how bad would it have been if Noah decided, listen, I'm just going to IKEA to have a boat in a box, and I'm going to put this thing together, and it's probably going to be way better than what God gave him. I'm telling you, he would have had that sinking feeling in a hurry if he didn't follow exactly as God instructed him to do. He had a pattern. He expected Noah to follow, and Noah seemed to understand that. Moses had the same lesson learned. We see in Exodus 25 and verse 40, God comes out and says, "Listen, I gave you instructions. I gave you a pattern when you were in the mountain. Follow that." And so when it came time to build the tabernacle, this place of worship, that Moses had the instructions, and he followed them and had the people follow them, just like God designed. And so we look in Romans chapter 6, verse 17, "But thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient to the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed. And having been set free from sin, become slaves of righteousness." Again, this standard of teaching. There is a standard way for us to become Christians. There is a standard way for us to live righteously. There is a standard way that God has laid out for us to be able to walk into heaven. And over again, we see patterns given, patterns followed, and God's happy. We also have sometimes patterns given. Man decides my way's better, and God is not happy. There's consequences on both sides. We want the good consequences by following the pattern that God has given us. 2 Timothy 1 and verse 13, "Follow the pattern of the sound words that you've heard from me in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus." And you've probably been told this. I've been told this. You know, again, something as simple as the church. Well, this is something that man's made up to kind of fill the gap to when Jesus comes back to try again to set up his kingdom. Again, totally against what we read about in the scriptures. But that's some people's version of what the church is. So we don't really have a pattern. We can do anything we want. It's ours anyway. Well, again, over and over again, we see in the scriptures this pattern of what God wants from us. And it is really, really dangerous to think of stepping outside this pattern that God's given us, moving away from fellowship with God. 2 John verse number 9, "Everyone who goes on ahead and does not abide in the teaching of Christ does not have God. Whoever abides in the teaching has both the Father and the Son. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not receive him into your house or give him any greeting. For whoever greets him takes part in his wicked works. And when we decide we have a better way, then we are running out in front of God. Instead of following in the footsteps of Jesus, we're showing Jesus which way we're going, and we expect him to follow us. He is not. The Lord is following God's instructions, and he expects exactly the same of us. And these patterns, of course, concerning our salvation, how he expects us to be obedient to him, for what we are supposed to do as a church, for how we worship him, how we are organized, how we are led, all of these different things. Again, all of these patterns that God has given us, he expects us to follow. Are we? Finally, we see the testing of God. And yes, you better believe that Noah was tested. Again, a lot of times when we tell the story, it's Noah, he builds an ark, he's got his family there, puts it together, animals come on, he hangs out in the boat for a little while, and then he gets done, and they, you know, lets a few birds out, and once the water's gone, then he, you know, sacrifices. I mean, poor animal, made it all that time on the boat, and then comes out and gets sacrificed. But again, sacrifices to God, and you know, it's the end. I know Hollywood's come up with a few different versions of how difficult it must have been for Noah and his family. Next time you read through that, think on it. Focus on what it would have been like. Again, before, during, and after. Now, before, again, as he's building this ark. And remember, it hasn't rained yet. I mean, if you had the job of a weatherman, oh, that must have been great back in those days. Well, no rain again today is in the forecast. Not that we know what that is. because, again, the mist watered everything. And so here he is building this ark. And, you know, we know how people are. I don't think we've changed a whole lot in 6,000 years. And do you think anybody made fun of him for building this big box and what he was going to do with it? He's going to save his family. He's going to save a whole bunch of animals because God has spoken to him and said he's going to flood the earth. Why don't you come on and get on the boat with us? That just sounds crazy. And so he probably had to put up with that for a really long time. About 100 years. And then comes the day, the animals come on, his family goes on the boat, the world is introduced to rain, the mountains move, the floods come, and people figure out too late, oh no, he was right. I know where I can be safe. I'm going to go to Noah. I'm gonna accept his invitation. I'm going to get on that boat so that I too can float away to safety. And you get there and the door is closed and who knows how many people were banging, screaming, begging, Noah. Noah, you know me. You invited me. Let me come on. Save me. Not even save me. Save my family. Save my wife. Save my children. I have a baby out here. Just open the door. See, God had closed the door. It wasn't Noah's to open. And then the banging and pleading and begging stopped. And he knew what that meant. Everybody's dead. I hope we don't spring a leak. Because I know what's out there. It's a bunch of water. Of course, then I'm sure it was a wonderful cruise. I see pictures of people on boats all the time today. They look like they're having a great time. It's probably not exactly like you go on a cruise today. Probably the smell is a little bit different. Sounds, and I'm sure wood still creaked back then. I don't know, maybe gopher wood was uncreaking wood. But again, you all of the sounds and probably got used to eventually, you know, doing this. And for a really long time, floated. Again, he didn't put the motor on it, didn't have the sail. It was a floating box until it didn't float anymore. It landed. Eventually, so they who let the birds out? That was no. They are able to take the top off, see the sunshine again, and eventually make it out to dry ground. It was quiet, I'm sure. The hustle and bustle of people that they knew before was no more. And again, that realization of, we're it. This group of eight people, that is it. We're all there is. But we're alive. Let's thank God for that. That was extremely difficult. Why would God put Noah through that? Again, what a way to destroy mankind and the rest of the world. And then Noah lived through it. I know he probably didn't get to go visit the psychologist or psychiatrist. I don't know who would do this, but you know, there was probably some survivor's guilt. Why am I still alive? And thousands and thousands and thousands were dead. They were alive because God showed grace. They were alive because God gave him instructions to follow. If you want to survive, here's how you do it. Fully rely on me, and I will save you. And he did, and was rewarded. We see that in Exodus chapter 14. Again, could God have had the fleet of planes land there in Egypt, get everybody loaded up and fly them over to the land of Canaan, and they'd be there in just a few hours? I mean, they'd have to go through, baggage claim, and it'd take them a little while to get out of the airport. But they'd have made it in just a little amount of time if God wanted them to go that way. Instead, again, he shows his power by the plagues and allows them to escape the land of Egypt and then puts them at death's door. You've got the Red Sea, and you've got the Egyptian army. There's no way out. Oh, unless God wants to make a way for you. He says, fully rely on me. Trust me. And I will get you out. Because I'm the only one who can. Waters part. They walk through on dry ground. The Egyptian army gets out there. Waters come back together. They don't swim very well. Sometimes we go through some trials that, how does God expect me to get out of this? Fully rely on him. The same way that we've seen example after example after example in the scriptures, trusting in him. He is going to be able to get us through. You've probably seen this if you spend any time online. We have the version of this is how we expect our life with God as a Christian, as being obedient. Oh, this is going to be great. This is the easy street. I'm just going to roll right along and finally reach the promised land and make it to heaven one day. And yet, life happens. There are things that get in our way sometimes. Sometimes we may think, well, there's no way I can get out of this. There's no way. This is going to be really, really hard. How do I get out of this? And, well, there's only one way, and that's His way. But that keeps pushing us back to Him. Now, James chapter 1 says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. When bad things happen, when sometimes your faith is tested, when people push back against you, high five. You should be excited about it. You know what's happening? Your faith's being tested. And when we fully rely on God, trust Him, and follow after His way, our faith is going to be stronger. And so the next time we have something come up, it was, oh no, what do I do? It's, oh yeah, that's right. I've got God. I can fully rely on Him. I know I'm going to be okay. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. Let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. See, the pretty cool thing is trials allow us to determine whether we're truly committed to God or not. See, God already knows. And we have someone like Abraham. Abraham, I know you've been waiting for a few years, about a century, for your son that I promised you. I need you to take him and kill him. So he heads off. 3-day journey. Gets really close to doing it until God stops him. Did God know that Abraham was faithful? Yes. Now Abraham knew. No matter what God tells me I need to do, I'm going to do it because I am faithful to Him. We can teach ourselves. And it starts with Matthew 6:33. Seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Is that our first thought? Because that was Noah's first thought. God said, build an ark. He's going to flood the earth. What's a flood? Well, okay, it doesn't matter. God said, build an ark. Let's go ahead and do that. And it worked out for him. God says, obey the gospel. God says, live the way that's laid out here. Follow after the pattern that my son has left. Completely obedient to God. Even if it meant his life. Are we willing to commit that much, seeking first his kingdom no matter what? That's what he expects of us. It'll be worth it. This morning we're going to sing a song to encourage each other. Again, it's not that God has created us as robots and we flip the switch so that we can then go into autopilot and God's just going to, you know, use the remote control to move us which direction we need to go. God has a plan for us. Live righteously. And then at Judgment Day, welcome to heaven. He wants that for every single person that's ever lived on this planet. Let Him have His way with thee. Choose to follow after God and His will. Over and over again we see in the Scriptures, it will be worth it. And here's one more reminder for us to encourage each other that reminds us it's going to be worth it. But maybe you have questions about it. Maybe you have something in the way. Maybe sin is in your life and you need to be able to get rid of it. Well, again, we can help with that. Let's talk about it. Let's study about it. We'll go back to what we first started with. Let's see what the Bible says about it. And then let's go from there. But this morning, make the choice to let Him have His way with you. And if there's something we can do to help with that choice, let us know as we stand and sing.
Would you live for Jesus and be always very good? Would you walk with Him within the narrow road? Would you have Him bear your burden, carry all your load? Let Him have His way.
good to see Mike with us again, too. Remember those announcements that were made earlier, and let's continue to do what we can to encourage one another. This time, Roy is going to lead us in our closing prayer, and also we'll offer thanks for the food that we're about to enjoy together. So let's pray together.
Let's pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your great and matchless name. We come before your presence now with praise and thanksgiving for your word, and pray that we will study it and apply it to our lives, and we'll be better people and better Christians in your sight. Watch over us, Father. Care for us. Take all of us home safely, we pray in Christ's name. Amen.